Hello and welcome everyone to the next presentation of the second edition of the A4Q World Congress. I am pleased to be here with Stefan Sturm, the Managing Director at IRAP GmbH, and his Deputy Managing Director, Stan Bühne. Together, they are going to talk about designing digital solutions in agile environments, requirements engineering meets digital design. So a very interesting and important topic nowadays. You will hear about the new CPRE Foundation Level 3.0 and the new digital design professional. And most important, how these two in combination help to tackle the challenges of digital transformation with respect to identifying requirements, but also with respect to designing solutions. So if you have questions and comments during the presentation, please feel free to enter them into the chat and during the Q&A session at the end of the presentation, then we will come back to them. So I think that's already everything from my side. Now I'm looking forward to the topic. And with this, I'm passing over to Stan and Stefan. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Erika, for the introduction. As Erika mentioned, my name is Stefan Sturm. I'm the Managing Director of the IRAP GmbH. I'm kind of dinosaur in IRAP. I'm Managing Director for the last 10 years, and IRAP started it off in 2006, 2007. So it's time to get one of the new wild guys into the topic, and this is my colleague, Stan Bühne, who will introduce himself.
Yeah, the new guy is that's me, as Stefan already mentioned. So I'm at the IRAP for about 2 years now. But nevertheless, I was in touch with IRAP, with the association, I think about 7 years before, joining several working groups for requirements management and also pushing forward the EU requirements, CPRE for requirements version 3. And yeah, I think that's pretty much the things from my side.
Okay, so we have prepared a kind of panel discussion for you. It's a discussion, an interview. We have prepared only a few slides. So nevertheless, I would like to ask to show the slides. Okay, again, Stan and me. And so let's get into the topic. I will give you a short background on the IRAP CPRE. So we are certifying people in requirements engineering since 2007. And we are very successful in that. We have certified people in over 80 countries all over the globe, about 70,000 certification exams run. And so the CPRE, this is the foundation level. The CPRE foundation level is very, very successful during the last, let's say, almost 15 years. But recently we realized, not only recently, already quite a while back, that we require new approaches for agile environments. So it was time to revamp the foundation level, the CPRE foundation level, and we came along with the foundation level 3.0 in October last year. It was launched in English and German, and we have an ongoing process in translating all the stuff to all the languages which we offer. We offer about 13 languages, including Chinese, Portuguese, French, Polish, Swedish, name them. The young guys around with Stan, they have phrased 9 really important principles of good RE, and I want to discuss with Stan on these 9 principles, because it's quite a very important part in the foundation level 3.0, and we cannot cover the whole foundation level syllabus here, but if we talk about the principles, you will get a good overview what is in the foundation level. So Stan, the 9 principles for good RE, why did you come along with 9 principles right now after about 15 years? I think the principles must have been there ever since. But what is new about it? Why are you coming along in foundation level 3.0 with the 9 principles?
Well, yes, of course. I think the principles are, let's say, pretty major, and most of them more or less knows such kind of principles. But I think what we have never talked about is some kind of making these principles more explicit. And also that we have this kind of principles doesn't matter if we are, let's say, in a more plan-based or waterfall process, or if we are an agile process. And I think that's why we established in our working group and said, hey, what is the real matter of requirements engineering? And that's why we came off talking about these principles and introducing these principles.
Okay. So that means you are making them more explicit in the syllabus as of today. But they, in fact, all these things have been in the foundation level before, but rather spread all over the syllabus and not being explicit, right?
Exactly, yes.
Okay, then let's shortly dive into the nine principles. The first one is requirements are a means to an end. We are the quote is a value orientation. What is behind that?
I mean, if you look on a requirements engineering process, and I think many companies do requirements engineering, hopefully, and often requirements engineering is seen as a kind of hassle. There's, let's say, a lot of work that needs to be done, a ton of documentation and so on. And what is this principle about is making some kind of awareness that you need to have some kind of value orientation, and requirements are not, let's say, the goal for itself. There is a means behind requirements, and it depends. So if you have, let's say, if you just, for instance, simply change the name of a button in your ordering system, for instance, then you don't need a huge RE process or a ton of documentation. But if you, for instance, create a completely new sales system, then for sure you need to think about what needs to be documented, what is the best process, and so on. And this is what we talk about, value orientation.
So this means a trade-off of the effort you put into RE compared to the benefit you get from implementing something specific, a specific requirement, right?
Yes, exactly. It's the benefit, and also, let's say, making a trade-off about the risk of not doing requirements engineering or not documenting something.
So how costly it would be if you miss a requirement or specify a wrong requirement, you might have a damage and the risk resulting. This is a cost. So this is a trade-off of the benefit and the costs and the effort you put into that, right?
Exactly. Yes.
Okay. Then the second one is RE is about satisfying the stakeholder. So stakeholder analysis has been in requirements engineering ever since. What are you focusing on here?
Yeah, hopefully stakeholders are not new for the ones doing requirements engineering outside, but just take in mind, I mean, products are getting more and more complex. It's not only the business department who has some claims or demands in a new product. There are a lot of other people, like product marketing, your users for sure itself, sales agents, service agents, but also the operations departments, law, regulations, and whom else who is using the products. And sometimes, anyhow, you don't even know your right, let's say, users of the product. Then you need to come up maybe with some kind of personas, think about who is using this new product. And that's okay. All about stakeholders.
Okay. Good solutions are impossible without shared understanding. Creating shared understanding is one of the core, using the English word, of the core activities of requirements, that you are creating shared understanding within the stakeholder group. What is new about that one?
So what's new? I mean, as you already mentioned, shared understanding is key in requirements engineering. So it was, or it should have been key 10 years ago and now. But as mentioned, you have more agility, more changes today, and you have also some kind of heavyweight and lightweight processes. It's quite important to know what are you talking about if you are building a product. So this means you need to know what is your, let's say, scope for the product, but also you need to talk about what are the limitations. So it means what is not done and what are your assumptions when you're creating a new product, and that needs to be clear to each and everyone. So this needs to need to have some kind of expectation management in the entire team, and also to the one who is, let's say, bringing the budget for your project. And I think that's all about shared understanding, that you, let's say, create some common knowledge about all participants, documented by documenting requirements, or by, let's say, also trying out something with prototypes, or with glossaries that help to understand that you have at least talks the same language, that you use the same terms, and so on. That's all about that.
Okay, that means to me, if you are in an agile team where the team is together for a long time and where people know each other very well and they know the topic very well, you might be able to achieve shared understanding just by discussion, sketching a few graphics and perhaps things like that. And if you have, let's say, a distributed team, or where you have high fluctuation, new people in the team, very complex things, you might need to have more documentation and prototypes and that stuff.
Yes, indeed.
Okay, fine. Things can only be understood in context. I think this is a very, very important part. Please give us some details.
Yeah. So when talking about context, and this is also nothing completely new, but we thought context is quite important in requirements engineering, because you need to know what are your boundaries you're working in, and what is really, let's say, the part of this, your system you're creating, or your product you're creating, and what is beyond, to just make clear, I'm only, let's say, designing or defining a kind of, for instance, checkout process for my new web shop, means just, let's say, I'm collecting name, address, and so on. Or is the scope also about to care about the payment provider, the logistic part, and so on? So it means how broad is your context? And I think this is really important for also to create your shared understanding afterwards. That's the major impact of context.
So as an example, a functionality may be very different depending on the context, whether you do just asking for personal data for a newsletter, or whether you want to implement some security critical things like a payment thing with the personal data.
Exactly.
Nice. Okay, the next one, I got a bit of a problem. With the problems, requirements, and solutions, that they are intertwined, because from the past, people have always been saying, hey, requirements engineering does not talk about solutions, we only specify requirements. Please give us a bit of an information here.
Yeah. I think if you look back, usually it was the idea to come from goals, objectives, to tackle an existing problem. And but nowadays it's getting more and more important to also think, let's say, what could be a solution, because a solution could also be, let's say, discussed then later on by, let's say, implementing a small prototype to see, for instance, how the interface would look like, how a certain functionality could look like for integrating whatever a payment provider or whatever. And I think this is really an interesting fact also to gather an, let's say, additional understanding, because if you see what is the solution, then you might find additional requirements, you might identify certain additional problems that, let's say, previously in later phase, or in previous ages where you have done software engineering, they will only appear if something is in production. I think the most important thing here is to learn from solutions and to learn how your requirements may be impacted and what additional problems will occur maybe.
Okay, this I think leads directly to the next one. Validation is key, the sooner the better. You have been talking about the prototypes and how to learn from that. I believe this is in the sixth principle, right?
This is one aspect of validation, but for sure, let's say in the very beginning, you may not start with some kind of software prototypes, but you may have some kind of paper prototypes if you're talking about GUIs or some kind of, let's say, screen flows for a web shop or whatever. But nevertheless, validation is more. Validation is also let's say, bringing people together, talking with them, making some reviews on your documents, on your use cases, on your user stories, on, let's say, entire requirement specifications whatsoever, and or to have some kind of walkthrough with your, let's say, more architects and so on to see, hey, is this really working the way the customer has desired it? And I think this is something where everyone could benefit from. So it's not that you say, hey, I'm just making my kind of validation only after an implementation in the test environment, but it's really important to make your validation as soon as possible also with your textual requirements or with your models.
Okay, this fits as well nice into an agile environment.
Absolutely.
Okay. Next one. Changes are no accident. So how about our good old change control board here?
Yeah, I mean, change control board may have also is also relevant today. But I mean, everybody knows who is doing requirements engineering or project management with a focus on requirements that you've just completed your specification. You just think everything is fine. Everything is completed. You just approve your specification for development, and then your phone rings and your product manager is just on the line and says, hey, I've just one minor change and this needs to be done as well. And here I think what needs to be in your mind is you cannot stop changes, and that's not our intention, also not in requirements engineering, but you need to think about how to handle changes. One way to handle changes is for sure this kind of change control board, very heavyweight RE process with change management and so on. But let's say in a in an agile environment, this will not work. But in an agile environment, you have other tools to handle changes. You have your backlog. You can reprioritize your backlog. You can see, okay, this needs to be done in the next kind of release or rollout. And I think the main thing is just to make the, let's say, elephant in smaller slices, not to have everything develop at once, but to think about smaller slices, smaller releases, and smaller, let's say, pieces that could be delivered and that create value as well.
Okay, and I believe with requirements engineering, let's name it traceability and things, we offer the proper tools to handle this change.
Absolutely. I mean, that's why also requirements management is still relevant, because for sure it doesn't matter if you're in an agile environment or in a, let's say, a more plan-based environment. You need to know where this change had impact you. This means you need to identify your requirements or your user stories and that need to be adopted with this change.
I'll come back to that one with the, I think, the ninth principle. How about the eighth one? Encourage innovation. More of the same is not enough, of course.
Yeah, I think the most important message here is that we need also people that will think out of the box. So this means the requirements engineer is not a secretary or typist only. So he should use his brain to, let's say, consult his customers, consult or to guide his stakeholders and to say, do not make the same mistake others have already done. And that's quite important, let's say, to learn, to be able to learn from your failures or from failures others did, and that you do not simply, let's say, digitalize a process that was previously, for instance, paper-based, and you just make it digital. That's not, let's say, a way to work today. So this means you need to be more innovative to, let's say, talk to people if this process still fits, to make some kind of adoption of the processes together with business analysts and so on.
But isn't that a way of how you interpret the role of a requirements engineer? I would say it could have been done before as well, but it's a bit of a different interpretation than the old-fashioned guys like me have looked at it, right?
Of course, I think I have already met. I've also met in my years when I was consultant, lots of people that really work in a way like that. That they really ask the people, the stakeholder, is this really what you want? And couldn't we make it somehow different? Would it be better to make it, let's say, another way? But there also, I think more than the half of, let's say, requirements engineers that simply say, hey, you tell me what you need, I will document this and I will provide this to architecture and development. And this is not a way that will work for the next 10 years.
Yeah, and in fact, it sounds like a boring job, right?
Absolutely, yes.
Okay, so then let's get back to the ninth one, which I like very much. It's still systematic and disciplined work. Hey, you still have to manage requirements and so on, right?
Yes, indeed. I mean, requirements engineering is work, and it is a kind of disciplined work. And it doesn't matter if you are in a lean RE process or in a huge or in a, let's say, major RE process, you need to handle your requirements and you need to think about what is the best process, what kind of requirements need to be documented. And this is a systematic work. And also, let's say, if some people think different, also agile doing it in the right way is some kind of disciplined work.
Okay. I think this should be enough for the overview of, on the CPRE, the new foundation level 3.0. It's out there. We need to speed up, I believe, a bit because we are running out of time otherwise, because now we want to get the move to the digital design professional. We touched it already a bit. Be innovative. Think about the solutions and how to learn from the solutions. So what we now think in IRAP that for some way in this digital transformation, we need pioneers. We need people who are more on a designing level than on a RE level. Nevertheless, RE still needs to be there. This is the important message, which we will point out later on. Stan, I'm a bit lost with this slide. Can you help me out here?
No worries. I will. Okay. So as you already mentioned, I mean, digital transformation needs some kind of more innovation, even if we have mentioned this in requirements engineering. But let's take a wonderful quote of Henry Ford to make this clear. He said, if I had asked people what they wanted, they would have said faster horses when he developed a vehicle. And this is exactly the thing. I mean, when building innovative solutions for a kind of digital transformation, we need some kind of new pioneers who really think different, who come up with solutions and who think in technology. And that's one slide to make clear that there are different facets. So on the right-hand side, we see, let's say, the technology aspect. But technology for digital solutions means you need to care about software and hardware in the same way, because if you, for instance, use your smartwatch, your Apple Watch, for instance, then there is an interconnection. Which parts are hardware and which parts are software? How do they? How can I integrate them? How do I get the best functionality out of this piece of, let's say, combined hardware and software? And on the other side, if you're talking about digital design, you also need to think about your business. So this means if you have, let's say, new technologies that could be used, for instance, for renting e-scooters or making car sharing a bit more attractive, then you could have an impact on your business model. This means you also need to think about digital business models that could be empowered by technology and so on. And finally, it's all about people, because people need to, let's say, use this new product you are creating. They need to be convenient with this product and so on.
Listening to you, I get the impression there's pretty much RE, requirements engineering, in that, right?
I mean, yes. On the one side, you have requirements engineering when going to the, let's say, analytical part, and let's say to find out what are the needs of certain stakeholders. But in many areas, when you are really say, I'm inventing something new, then it's more than requirements engineering, because otherwise you just build faster horses. So you really need to be someone who is knowing the material, and that's one of the next slides, I think.
Yeah.
When talking about your, let's say, digital solutions, and yeah, when we talk about digital material, we really mean that you get to know your hardware and software technologies. So like, let's say, a carpenter knows his materials like wood, steel, glass, etc. And he needs to know which materials can be used in which context, what are the real capabilities of this material, what are the limits. So this means not each and every material, not each and every, let's say, payment provider or GUI technology or even touch interface could be used in each and every environment. This means you need to know what are the materials available and how can I use them for a given context and how can I combine them for a given context.
Okay. So this is interesting. This is, I think this comes from the idea of an industrial designer, bit who knows how to build a cool building, which is not only serving a certain purpose, but at the same time looks very well and is stable enough and all these things, so that you are able to work with this material. So I think this is a quite new concept of this material.
Yeah, exactly.
And to make it clear, we cannot dive too deep into that topic here, but in the digital design professional syllabus and handbook, you will find it elaborated in depth. And of course, if you go for a training, you will be the term will be introduced very well.
Exactly.
Okay.
Then, when talking about this material, maybe just a few side notes on that one. It's quite important. It's, let's say, technology. It could be hardware and software. And if you look into the syllabus or in the handbook for the digital design professional, there's really a lot of introduction into this, let's say, digital material, what should be known to set up, let's say, good digital solutions in the future.
Okay, now, Stan, just a few words only, because we are running out of time.
Of course.
Prototypes, we already heard in the CPRE before.
Yeah, prototypes we heard in the CPRE, but here we go into to a kind of other direction. It's not only about validating things. Prototypes here is more about, let's say, playing with your material, playing with your technology to see, hey, I will try out, for instance, how your conference like Zoom, Teams, or GoToMeeting will work for my context. Before building, let's say, the entire solution, I think, especially digital material, like, let's say, the technologies we have, they are quite easy to use to set up some prototypes, some GUI prototypes, some, let's say, prototypes for checking out certain functionalities. And by creating these prototypes, you will anytime gain some additional understanding of your material, and you will gain some understanding of, let's say, possibilities for creating additional business, for widening your solution, and so on.
Okay. Now, does it mean that the digital design professional will replace the requirements engineer in the CPRE, or what's about that?
Yes, of course.
No.
No, just kidding.
You're fired.
No, just. Of course not. So in our point of view, the digital design professional and the requirements engineer, or as, let's say, the other roles you see here on this slide, they really, they are some kind of friends, because if you take requirements engineering and digital design, the requirements engineer is really needed for some analytical aspects to find out, if we are in this car example of Henry Ford, to find out what is really required for steering the car, what are the aspects for, let's say, controlling the wheels, for the requirements for the engine, and so on. And the digital design professional, he's the one who is, let's say, more the, let's say, pioneer in creating some new ideas and solutions, and he will pick up all the experts he needs, for instance, a software architect, a UX architect, or someone who is really an expert in whatever blockchain that is, for instance, needed in this new product. And that's more or less the idea of the digital designer. And to make it clear, the digital designer is not a kind of new role. It's more a kind of, let's say, new job or a new profile that's really introduced, like a software and a building architect.
Okay, I think that was pretty much on the CPRE and the DDP, how each of the topics is composed and how it is they are related to each other. So this is the end of our talk, our discussion, and we would like to ask you to post your questions, please.
Thank you so much, Stan and Stefan, for the interesting presentation and also the discussion between the both of you. So I think this makes it very understandable for the audience. So I really like the kind of style you've presented. Thanks a lot for that. So while we are checking the chat for question, or I can see there's already something displayed from Emilia. Software development could learn from automative way. With a smiley. I would like to take the liberty to ask the first question myself. So the first part of your presentation was about the CPRE foundation level, and we've learned a lot about the principles of good RE. So is there anything else that you would like to mention what changed beside those principles when we look at the new CPRE?
So what I could say, Stan was in the team, he can go in depth, but globally it was totally reorganized. In the past, all the activities and techniques have been presented in, let's say, a waterfall style. You could have run through the chapters and get the impression that this is waterfall. And the very important part was to present it in a different way to make clear that this is that RE is not tied to a process model. It is you can use all the techniques and models all over the different process models: agile, heavyweight, waterfall, name them. And this was a very important thing. And perhaps with respect to certain content, Stan, do you want to comment?
Sure. Yeah, sure. So as I already mentioned, I think this was somehow restructured on the syllabus. And for instance, in the EU Education Unit 3, we covered all the documentation things. And here we also try to make clear that it you should differentiate between things on, let's say, if you talk about documentation, about functional quality or whatever, that there are certain aspects on the, let's say, content that needs to be documented, but there are certain, or but there are also different kind of, let's say, models or ways to document them. You could document them by plain text, by templates, by models, and so on. And it doesn't matter. It really depends on the, let's say, on your organizational setting and on the settings of the people or on the setting of the project you are doing. So what is the best, let's say, documentation technique you use? And what's completely new, for instance, in the foundation level 3 is the education unit 5, where we talk about the processes in requirements engineering. So we already had this a bit with principle of value orientation. Here in this section, we really introduce an idea how your requirements engineering process could be somehow adapted to your own organizational settings in your own engineering process.
So that it needs to be shaped depending on the context. Back again to the context. It's never the same way how you do requirements engineering. This is specific to your context.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot for the explanation and the answers. So I have another question, which is then more related to the second part of your presentation regarding the digital designer. I still have difficulties how I can imagine the profession itself. So how can I imagine this person? Is it really an all-rounder who knows or can do everything? We had the slide with the different kind of experts, your UX expert, software architect, RE expert, designer in general. Maybe you can explain a little bit again about the role.
Should I? Yeah. So in general, I think the digital design professional, for sure, he is in theory one who knows the entire field of the, let's say, software process and about the technology part, about business processes, about, let's say, people management, how to get the right people on board, how to create specifications and so on. But in practice, this will never work out. So you anytime needs this kind of building team where the digital design professional is just one person in a bigger audience, and he will have a requirements engineer, for instance, focusing on the analytical part of requirements. He will consult an architect for aspects with software architecture, how things can be, let's say, really combined and so on. But I think the very important thing is that a digital design professional can have some kind of eye-to-eye talk with them, that he really knows what an architect is talking about, what a requirements engineer is talking about, or what a, let's say, usability engineer is talking about. I think this is quite important, because if you look in our today's software industry, you have this quite closed, let's say, roles of usability expert, requirements engineer, architect, and in the worst case, they don't even talk to each other. Yeah, they just make their work, they just throw their results over the fence and say, hey, my job is done, and just proceed. And the digital design professional is really the one who drives the innovation through the whole process, who's, let's say, actively shaping the new solution from the vision until the things goes into operations. I think this is something that's really new.
I think it's a person who has an understanding of all the different fields we have shown around, but not an expert in each and every of the fields, but just understands and is able to talk to the experts on eye level and understanding what they are talking about.
Yeah.
So if orchestrating the whole thing.
Exactly. So if you compare with, let's say, a building architect, for instance, for sure, a building architect would in theory be able to build his own house. But in let's say practice, he might build his new garden house. That might be quite nice. But it's a, let's say, really small project. But he will never, let's say, come to the idea to build his own shopping mall by himself. And this is really something where he will, let's say, also ask experts who will do the construction and so on.
Okay, thank you. So let's see what's going on in the chat. Is there anything coming in? From Emilia again. Currently, there aren't technical specialists, subject matter experts in software development.
There are, of course, there are technical specialists like the software architects. They are specialists in doing software architecture, but typically they don't care about business requirements. They just care about how to build software which is stable, maintainable, scalable, and secure, and all these things. But they don't care about business requirements, for instance, or if you ask, you know, we are talking about things like Twitter, like Facebook, like Instagram. These have not been things where requirements engineers have been sitting down and saying, okay, what could we do next here? And then they came across Twitter. It was people who had an idea, a genius idea, and then started to explore. And then once they said, okay, now we need to implement something, they need a requirements engineer who specifies the requirements for the things. They need a software architect to scale the software later on and all these things. So these experts are there, but there's no one in between who is able to say, okay, what's out there? What can we do with the technology out there? What can we do with mobile, with this streaming things and all these ideas to shape them? There is nobody out there doing that one.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you. So maybe, yeah, the last question, because then we are already coming to an end. So I think that's a question that I hear also more often. So is becoming RE less relevant now and in the future as we go more and more agile?
Stefan, do you want?
You're asking, of course not, of course not. Stan would say, yes, I will fire him again. So no, you know, agile, that's what we said before. In agile environment, you might not need to go into depth at the beginning, of course. Yeah. You know, you've got a vision and then you move forward. But the closer you come to implementing a certain feature, you need to know the requirements of the feature. And if you are doing a log-on procedure or a payment transaction thing, you need to know the interface specifications, you need to know security and safety things and all this, and this needs to be collected in some way. Are you asking the product owner? That's not what we hear very often. Yeah, we ask the product owner. Where does he know from, or she? Who is collecting these requirements? It's a requirements engineer. Or it's the task is requirements engineering. You need to know the methods and the techniques and how to apply them.
Yeah, exactly. And I think this is really the point. So I've really been in a lot of projects in the beginning where companies tried to move from, let's say, a more waterfall to a more agile process. And here you have seen in the very beginning, they try to say requirements engineering is not needed anymore because just the hassle is this ton of documentation we don't need that is just costing effort and time and money. But after a while, you have seen, hey, the projects will not come to an end because certain things like really interface documentations or aspects that are a bit more tricky that needs to be documented because even in a small team, you need to, let's say, talk about your requirements. And even if they are, let's say, documented in user stories, you may create also some kind of simple model to see how these things belong together, or you create some kind of user story map to see the end-to-end idea of your new product. And this is all, let's say, a kind of requirements engineering. Yes, a kind of, let's say, more lean requirements engineering. I think here also the skills of a requirements engineer are still needed.
Thank you for the further explanations. And I think with this, these are great statements now coming to the end of our session already. But if there are more questions coming up, so please, oh, there's one. Sorry, I missed that one. Architects are just for convergence. Technical specialist purpose is to write requirements and come with strategies for futures. Hmm. Do you have any comments to that one?
I'm not sure how. I think, Stan, do you understand the
I'm not fully get this point, but for sure, I mean, an architect or a software architect today is more, let's say, looking on the enterprise architecture and that everything may fits together. And the technical specialists, for sure, they are, let's say, writing requirements, but you need some kind of, let's say, requirements engineer still. I'm not sure if this is meant with the technical specialist in here.
Perhaps Emilia should come back to us directly.
Yeah, sure.
I don't know where you share our contact information. I would expect with the slides or where you post that. So we are happy to discuss that in later on.
Yeah,
I think that's a really great offer. Either directly go back to Stefan and Sturm directly, or you can also email to the General Congress email address, and then we will forward. Yeah. Another option is please join the social event this evening, Emilia. Hopefully, Stefan Sturm will also be there, and you will
meet him.
Exactly. So perfect. I think that's also something very important I wanted to mention at the end. So please don't miss the social event this evening. It's the A4Q Congress Oktoberfest starting at 7 o'clock in the evening. So with this, let me thank you again, Stefan and Sturm, for the presentation, for the discussion.
You're welcome.
Very interesting. Thanks everyone for joining, and then hopefully see you in the evening.
Thank you. Yeah.
Perfect. Thanks a lot. Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
This 27th of October, we wait for you to celebrate Oktoberfest in our Gather Town. For sure, it will be a very entertaining event with live music, with A4Q staff, and of course, all of you. Don't miss our A4Q Oktoberfest. It will be very fun. Prost!